Anyway, just to introduce myself, I'm Eddie Turnbull. I'm head of e-health in Scottish Government, and I think that's the wrong term to start with. Immediately I start with the wrong term, because I say e-health. It should be. I'm responsible for digital now health and care policy and strategy within Scottish Government. So I want to make that really clear from the start. So I'm really delighted to be here today to present to you and actually meet you, because I'm very, very conscious that this is not an audience I have engaged with. I'm conscious when I come along to present, often I look into the audience and it's the two that I don't recognise that make me think, I wonder who those two are, as opposed to, you know, everybody else. So I'm really, really keen to be here, and in fact quite interested to be here in this building, because I think this was where my first job was. I asked Tom, who were originally in this building before it was clearly refurbished, and I think it was an insurance company. And I'm sure I worked here when I left university as an actuarial assistant. And just to give you the contrast between the digital world and the paper world, I recall being down in the basement working on ledgers, you know, and doing the arithmetic on a calculator. It was an LED calculator. but the world has actually moved on. So let's see if we can get my slides up here. I'll move it on. Just a couple of other introductions. Zahid's going to speak in a moment about the person-centred focus of this. So I'll not speak too much about that. And I also think the room, there's a few folk from my team, I guess, if that's a way to put it, and that Keith Wilcock is in the room, Keith, so wherever you are, put your hand up. You don't get away sitting at the back of the room, by the way. Keith actually is very much involved in the tech programme around the platform piece. So if you catch Keith, you know, at some point in the break or whatever, if you're particularly interested in that, Keith can respond there. And Alistair Hodgson is somewhere who'll be on the panel later on, but Alistair is right up the middle of the tech programme as well. So, good to have a chat with him. And one final individual is Jonathan Cameron, is in the room somewhere. And Jonathan was the developer of the key information summary that is used considerably in health, in a health context, but I'll mention that a little later on in my talk. So, why am I here? I'm really here to set the scene, to highlight some key initiatives, and I hope linked to the workshops. I mean, as Tom's already said, throughout the day, I want you to think, if you can, from my presentation, that of others, you know, how we lead this change. That's my request to you today. You know, we are at a point where we need to move at pace, and we need to change our focus. So really that's my ask from you today. I mean, a key message is that, you know, we must think innovatively in how we do things, but we also must build on digital solutions that have been proven to work. You know, we should no longer be undertaken as I would see it, pilots. I think the way I would see it is now, is we're looking to really take things forward, scale them up, and actually, you know, we have obviously good examples, and we wish to promote those more broadly across Scotland. So as I say, you know, to date my focus in the strategy has been very much around health and social care integration has meant that I've got to shift my focus very much here. So it really is a personal objective of mine. Actually, is a personal objective. Look at my appraisal, there is a personal objective to say that I have to engage more with the care community, with the local authority community, and with the third sector in this. So once again, just to say, it's an ideal opportunity for me to do that. I think just to herald the fact that we have an e-health strategy, a current e-health strategy, it does cover the care element, and the approach has been in e-health to take things in an incremental way and build on the investment that's been made. And it's been highly effective, I suggest, because we've achieved quite a lot, an awful lot, but you know, with value for money. It's not been similar to other investments perhaps that have happened south of the border, which have evaporated. So we've built a foundation here, but there are significant drivers now that mean that we have need a step change in what we're doing, a change in pace and a broader perspective on where digital technology can really make an impact. We've still got major functionality gaps. Don't let me think for one moment everything is perfect in the health world, in the acute world. It's not. And we don't have the connectivity even within health. But we really have to, and in fact, I wouldn't say shift our focus, but broaden our perspective here, because we have a job to do within health, don't get me wrong still, but we have an absolute job to do in terms of integration of health and care solutions in the community. I'm not going to labour the slide, it's just there for information in your pack. But you know, if there are suppliers in the room, and I think there will be a few in terms of technology suppliers, this is my pitch for Scotland, really. Scotland is the ideal place to build a strong digital health and care economy. You know, we are small enough to get all the leaders into a room, and we have the innovation centres now established where they should be a fertile place for suppliers to come with technology solutions and actually investigate and trial how these could be used in real situation to provide real benefits. So just wanted to mention that. Anyway, quick question, I thought, just for a bit of you, audience participation. I attended another event where this chap just reeled off fact upon fact about, you know, digital technology, you know, its prevalence, what it could do. And that was one of the questions that he said. So plagiarism here, but you know, what percentage, I don't know where the survey came from, but has anybody got any ideas how many people take their smartphone to bed with them? You know,
25.
Really, it's about, well, I mean, 75% apparently is that actually take the smartphone into bed with them. So, Henry, are you one of the
even 10? I have myself, yeah.
Right. I won't labour these either. I mean, you'll be familiar with the challenges of stretched public finances, an ageing population living with multiple and chronic conditions, and the profound health inequalities that exist within Scotland. Services are generally disjointed. People are admitted to hospital and delayed in hospital when they'd be better cared for at home or in the community. And the demographic profile, which I think Tom mentioned as well, is contributing to the increasing shortage in health and care professionals. The use of online services, mobile technology and social media is pervasive, and expectations are high. We've spoken about that. In health and care, that means the expectations, not just of the citizen, it's the expectations of the citizens, professionals and researchers, individuals that can use that data to make service improvement. Even though I'm going to be talking more about the technology-enabled care, I want to just say that, you know, that data analytics is the most powerful thing I think we can have in terms of planning our services and planning treatment and planning care for individuals. So again, that's a real emphasis that I think digital can deliver, especially if we're all connected up, not in an analogue way, but in a digital way. So the challenge is transformation, isn't it? You know, and it's not going to happen overnight, but across the world it's been demonstrated that digital technology can be the key transformative agent in new ways of providing personalised health and care. And it's a joint effort. It's not a singular thing, and I've just highlighted here some of the the agents that are involved in delivering this. And really, to do this, we need to have a shared vision. And the shared vision is really simple, isn't it? You know, everybody recognises this. And it is that everyone is able to live longer, healthier lives at home or in a homely setting. So everything that we do should be focused on that. For the health and care community, sensor technology is already proving to be a game changer. By 2020, sensor technologies will be all-pervading, transmitting data directly to the internet for immediate alerts and for data analytics. For example, it's now possible and deemed safe, I should say, to embed a sensor in a tablet, okay, and measure actual medication taking patterns and physiological responses from a smartphone, from a tablet that's or that you've just swallowed with a, you know, something, and so it's incredible. That's the direction that we're moving in. And this is all going to require connectivity. So the Digital Scotland programme is a key step in Scottish Government's aim for Scotland to become a world-class digital nation by 2020. Bringing high-speed broadband to Scotland is one of the most ambitious infrastructure programmes across the whole of Europe. It's anticipated that 95% of homes and businesses across Scotland will receive fibre broadband by 2018. When the existing plans are complete. That's the endeavour. And it's been delivered through two programmes that you're probably aware of, probably more directly aware of than I am, in fact. And the first is through the Highland and Islands, and the second one is covering the rest of Scotland. So the investment is significant. The Highland Islands project has a £145.8 million investment, and the rest of Scotland is a £264 million project, and then there's a further £42 million now being added to that through European and match funding. So a massive investment in getting this right, because the government recognises that the ambitions that we're going to speak about today cannot be realised without the appropriate infrastructure in place. I'm really going to touch on this quickly, but does everybody recognise the Kaiser model? I think this is a key model. It's a key enabler for us to prioritise where we should focus and where our investment should be. And it does recognise that generally 20% of the population requires about 80% of the resource, and we know that. As if people are admitted to hospital, then the cost increases significantly. The cost to us as individuals, the taxpayer, but the cost to the individual, the cost to that individual's family. So in terms of emotional terms. So we use this often in terms of developing a policy, but I think it's always something that's worth highlighting. An initiative I want to touch on here, though, is the centrepiece for care of those near the top of the pyramid, is the care plan. So I mentioned earlier the key information summary, which has been very successful in health. It has its limitations, and the objective is to develop a digital care plan that is shareable and dynamic. It should enable multidisciplinary working. It should have care coordination, workflow and alerts built into it so that pertinent information can be dispatched to individuals, and alerts can be, the individuals can be notified who are in the circle of that individual's care when they need to take action. You know, for example, if someone's, it's a basic thing, isn't it? But if someone is admitted to hospital, then those providing social care should know. Immediately, so building that into a care plan is our objective. And there's examples of this working elsewhere. So just yesterday I had a demonstration of what they have in Northern Ireland, which is really worth looking at, and something that's been implemented in Bristol by one of the suppliers that supplies to, you know, Scotland. So, you know, this isn't all at the leading edge of technology. I think Tom was saying that it's here now. I think you'll all be familiar with the Health and Social Care Integration Act. So really, in the interest of time, I'll jump over that. And again, the nine agreed health and wellbeing outcomes, which are the focus of delivery within the new partnerships. But they're in the slide deck, which you can refer to. And I really would just want to then turn my attention to the tech programme. Margaret Walisky is the programme lead from Scottish Government on that now. I'm sure you know Margaret better than me, so she apologises that she couldn't be here today. She's on holiday. But it was initiated in 2015, with the first year's funding available in 2015-16. And the government committed £10 million last year to that programme, and with a further £9 million in the next 2 years. So it's a very focused programme around building on and scaling up tech. And I'll just touch on a few of the aspects of that. So it's tied to the health and wellbeing outcomes, which we saw earlier. It's designed to specifically extend the number of people directly benefiting from technology-enabled care and support in Scotland. It's aimed at reducing duplication of effort and introducing integrated services at scale. Local partnerships have been asked to show how technology-enabled care contributes to avoiding unnecessary hospital admissions, reduces the length of stay in hospital, and prevents delayed discharges from hospitals in all locations throughout Scotland. So that was an underpinning requirement of that. And we've created five key workstations that are within the tech programme. So if you're not familiar with these, here they are. Extending the use of home health monitoring, expanding the use of video conferencing across all health and social care sectors, as well as growing its use for clinical practitioner consultations. Building on emerging digital platforms to enable direct access to advice and assistance. Expanding the take-up of telecare with a focus on prevention and points of transitions in care, particularly around dementia. And exploring the scope and benefits, which will be interesting to this discussion today, of switching from analogue to digital telecare. So briefly, there's a few slides I've got here on each of these, but I guess you can look at that, those at your leisure. What I'd like to do is jump a couple forward and talk about the digital platform piece, which Tom mentioned. This is a largely a national piece of work, and it's focused on defining a national digital platform architecture supporting the Once for Scotland principle. The aim is to easily support the transfer of data recorded on remote monitoring devices into clinical and care systems that can be monitored and used by clinicians and care providers. This effectively provides a transport layer model to allow information to be shared from these remote devices with clinical and care systems, and allows the clinical and care community to act on that information. The remote monitoring landscape is clearly complex, and this is a really challenging thing to address. So we've created a document. It's not actually out there for public consumption yet, but we will very soon, I hope it will be. And really it's a 100-page document, and it talks about a unified reference architecture. That's my first technical reference of the day. And its intention is to describe how we, you know, this we will arrange an integrated solution to support telehealth, telecare, a citizen face portal, and a clinician care facing portal. It's that bit in the middle that will join everything together, and I'll touch on that briefly later. Since we do have a telecare audience, particularly, I just touch on this. For year one of the programme, 17 health and social care partnerships received funding through the programme to expand the take-up of telecare. And thanks to the commitment, engagement and enthusiasm from the partnerships, we're on target to reach our projected outcome to expand the take-up of telecare with around 8,000 new users of telecare services. But generally, that's analogue services. So a key workstream, I guess, linked to the platform workstream is the analogue to digital piece. It's going to be something that will develop over the next year or two. It's not something that's going to be absolute immediate, so that'll frustrate Penny in terms of pace, I'm sure, and you all. But you know, we will build to this. But we've undertaken a feasibility study as part of the tech programme for moving existing analogue telecare to digital telecare. Phase one of the feasibility study reported back in October 2015, setting out the evidence base and the current profile for Scotland's alarm receiving centres. Phase two and three of the feasibility study have just been completed, and the results will be published soon. And this looks at the technical aspects of change involved, but not yet the service aspects, not how we might change the back office service around that. So I don't want to, you know, raise your expectations on that, but it's a phased approach as we consider this. What I would like to touch on now is really, we recognise that it's not just about integration somehow at one place. It's integration across a number of areas in terms of digital capability. You know, we know that smart devices can be used to sense, record and communicate both health and wellbeing information. So really, we don't want to have an individual with a device here for care, and then an individual here with a device for health purposes. It should be one device. There should be, in the home or the care home, a single concentrator, something that draws that information to one point. Again, we don't want different points of reception within the home. Different points of reception need different points of maintenance. We are looking to unify that. Ideally, this should be processed through a common information exchange hub, a common platform that can route the information appropriately. But I should say, just before anyone gets some false idea about that, when I mentioned once for Scotland, it doesn't necessarily have to be that there is only one of them sitting somewhere in the centre of Scotland. There can be a distributed model around this clearly, but what we're looking for is standardisation and integration. And then there's the potential for a common first responder service, and Tom gave me a sneak preview of the centre here, and how the potential is there for a coordinator there to coordinate health and care providers at one point, rather than have it maybe, you know, split or diffused across a number. And really, actually, without, you know, we shouldn't forget at the back end there needs to be coordination. We need to ensure that, going back to that shared care plan, those alerts, that all those involved in an individual's health and care are suitably notified of the situation. How am I doing for time, Penny? So, this and the next diagram are taken from the unified architecture document that I spoke about earlier. We now have a model of how a common approach might be implemented. And as I say, it doesn't say there should only be one, as there can be regional models to this as well. The important piece here is around standardisation. So I really want to get some feedback today around your thoughts on that. How practical is that? How achievable is that? And it describes, this is the summary document, I can assure you. The other document describes what each of these components has to do. It is complicated. It provides an ability for both NHS and health and social care partnerships to agree this a standard method of information sharing and agree what should be shared and the system to support that. It does not stop local innovation though, or the ability to vary data sharing to suit local needs, but does provide a consistent way for data to be shared and interpreted, though that's an important part, by healthcare and social care professionals. Two more slides, I think, and then I'll leave it there. What I've listed here are you know, in terms of our consultation with mainly health and care workers in the community, these are the issues. These are the issues that folk experience out there, and I hope these actually mean something to you. But again, happy if I've not captured that, give me some feedback. Of course, when we take those, and particularly the last one, which is not necessarily a technology one, but is one that's close to my heart, is to debunk you know, some of the myths around what you can and can't share, and make that clear. So I've actually got a team for the first time in St Andrew's House who are very much focused on not the technology information sharing, but the policy around it, and make getting clarity around this. So again, if there's anything that isn't familiar to you there or it doesn't resonate, please let me know. So probably my final piece is you know, the development of such things as a shareable and dynamic care plan, and using the unified reference architecture, I believe will have a significant impact going forward. But health and social care workers are looking for simple solutions now. You know, I appreciate that now. You know, things such as sharing calendars and exchanging messages and you know, just sharing emails, I think are the more practical thing. So we are working closely with partnerships in solutions that will enable that to happen. Just picking the low hanging fruit first of all. And that's the feedback we've had from chief officers of the integration, you know, joint boards. So it's a journey at a local level, it's a journey at regional level, and really there's things that we can be doing at national level. And I'd be really keen to tease that out at the panel session if that's appropriate, or in the workshops. So, I've left some slides at the end, which are just a series of things that we need to do. And again, you can look at those at your leisure. But this is an interesting. I thought at the end I would bring in two other things that chap brought up in the 80s survey. So the one on the left is an interesting pictogram, which suggests how much time we spend in the bathroom, and how that increases with the availability of, first of all, your mobile phone, then your mobile or your smartphone, the Wi-Fi, and then actually if you've got power, you can see the and the other one's an interesting one, the technology can actually not be that helpful. That was pointed out, that's at Haymarket Station. And you can imagine us, most of us in the room, understanding that I put my smartphone against that, it will download the timetable. But can you imagine my elderly aunt, who wants to know when she can get the train, you know, back, you know, to Glasgow and back again? Talk about that means nothing to her. So, okay, I'll leave it there. Thank you very much. And